Hello, welcome to the topic on Hermite shape functions for a beam element in a local coordinate system. My name is Muthanna Bandar, SG Balekundra Institute of Technology, Belgaum. Before going to the Hermite shape functions for the beam in a local coordinate system, let us recall what we have discussed in a previous class. So we have discussed about what is called as a shape functions in a global coordinate systems. So which were n1 is equal to some cubic equation, n2 is equal to cubic equation, n3 is another cubic equation, and n4 is also a cubic equation. So we got n1, n2, n3 and n4 as a shape functions in a global coordinate system. So using this global coordinate system, we arrived at the transverse displacement equation, which is a function of a shape function as well as the vector displacements, like displacement vectors like v1 theta 1, v2 theta 2. So the equation is in the form of a global coordinate system. Now the main focus is to convert this global coordinate system into a local coordinate system. Then why should we convert this global to a local coordinate system? Because the calculation in FEM happens at a local coordinate system, so it becomes very important to understand what are the shape functions in a local coordinate system. And also, to start with, let us consider a beam of a length L. It is discretized into a n number of elements, and those elements are numbered as 1, 2, 3 up to n, and those are encircled with a circular thing. Similarly, I have numbered the nodes as 1, 2, 3 up to n plus 1. So these are called as a global node numbering scheme. And also, those node numbers are represented by the coordinates. These are called as a global coordinates like x1, x2, x3 and so on up to xn plus 1. Now, I will take one element out of this. Let us consider k element and put it into a natural coordinate system or a local coordinate system. So here in a local coordinate system, I am considering a 2D beam element which has a length of hk and the node numbers are 1 and 2. The coordinates are x1 and x2. Similarly, at a node 1, there are 2 degrees of freedom, 1 transverse displacement, 1 angular displacement. At node 2, v2 is a transverse displacement, theta 2 is a angular displacement. So we follow what is called as a local node numbering scheme. So you can see that the numbers that are written here are in a local coordinates, like it is different from this global coordinate system. Similarly, the local notations of a nodal coordinates are x1 and x2, and also the element degrees of freedom are represented as v1, theta 1, v2, theta 2. Now, since as earlier stated that we need a minimum 2 degrees of a freedom. So those 2 degrees of a freedom are primary variable is that is transverse displacement and its first derivative will give the angular displacement. And these 2 degrees of freedom are required per node to ensure the continuity of the approximation. So totally there will be a 4 degrees of freedom. 2 on each node of the element. So hence we have a 4 linear independent basis function. And also we choose a first 4 polynomial function as a basis function. Hence we can represent the transverse displacement field approximation for a kth element as a cubic equation, cubic polynomial equation as v of x is equal to a0 plus a1x plus a2 x square plus a3 x cube. Later we will convert this global coordinate system into a local coordinate system. So we will discuss about this local and global relations in a later stage. So here you remember zeta is in a local coordinate system and x is in a global coordinate system. So this already we have discussed in a previous session. Like I told, n1, n2 and n3 and n4 are a global shape functions, and we call these shape functions as a cubic Hermitian interpolation polynomials. The reason is these shape functions are similar to the functions that are developed by the Hermitian interpolation polynomials. Hence the name is called as a Hermitian shape functions. Okay, so now in terms of a shape functions, the approximate transverse displacement equation in a global coordinate system becomes as v of x is equal to n1 v1 plus n2 theta 1 plus n3 v2 plus n4 theta 2, where n1, n2, n3, n4 are global shape functions. v1 and v2 are the transverse displacement at node 1 and node 2. Theta 1 and theta 2 are the angular displacements at node 1 and node 2 respectively. So here, now I have to transfer this global coordinate system to the local coordinate system. So I have made a different notations for this one. So x is a global, zeta is a local, n1 is a global shape function, h1 is represented as a local Hermitian shape functions, and n2 and h2, n3 and h3, n4 and h4. So basically this is converted into local coordinate system. So we have to derive what are these h1, h2, h3 and h4. So let's do that. And also make a note of this one. Like if I consider this as a beam, and this is v1, which is a transverse displacement, and this is a first degree of a freedom for the node 1, and that is associated with a say function n1 or h1. Similarly, the second degree of a freedom is theta 1 at a node 1, and it is associated with a say function n2 in a global, h2 in a local. Similarly, if I take at a node 2, v2 represents n3 or h3, and theta 2 represents n4 or h4. So here I want to highlight that the first degree of freedom, that is v1 here and v2 at node 2, will take a odd number n3, h3, h1, n1. And similarly, the second degree of a freedom, at a node 1 will take a even number n2 and h2, and here at node 2 n4 and h4. So this is the note I wanted you to consider. So further moving, already we know that transverse displacement function is written in a shape functions, global shape functions, and a displacement vector. And you note here this theta is written as dv by dx, so which is the first derivative of a displacement. So now I have to convert this dv by dx into what is called as a local coordinate system, because the local coordinate system is in terms of zeta now. So substituting that, so theta, this dv by dx or theta is replaced by the dv by dx when it is written in a local coordinate system. So in a local coordinate system, this equation becomes v of zeta is equal to h1 v1 plus h2 dv by d zeta at node 1 plus h3 v2 plus h4 dv by d zeta at node 2. So now when I transfer this global to a local coordinate system, I should understand what is the relation between the global coordinate system and local coordinate system. So that relation is given by this equation, which is x is equal to L e by 2 into 1 plus zeta, where x is a global and zeta is a local. So that is explained here. Let us consider, if I take this as a global coordinate and I will consider a element in a local coordinate. Now this is a x global, so I will say at a some point here is a x, and this is a local, so zeta is equal to 0. This is a local coordinate system and this is a global coordinate system. But I want the result in a global coordinate system, but the calculation happens in a local coordinate system. So first I will transfer this global into a local, calculate the things in a local coordinate system, then whatever the results that comes out of a FEM will be transferred back to the global coordinate system. So this is how the FEM works on that. So zeta is equal to 0 here. So this is zeta is equal to minus 1 and zeta is equal to plus 1 here. Now there is a relation. I want to find what is the behavior of an element at a distance of x from the global coordinate system in this local element. For that, I will find what is the value at this point through this local coordinate system and then transfer it to a global coordinate system. So this relationship between the natural and the global is explained by this equation. So I will be using this relation to substitute to convert this into a local coordinate system. So for that, I will differentiate this dx is equal to L by 2, I will keep as it is, and differentiation of 1 is constant is 0, differentiation of zeta is d zeta. I will rearrange this equation as dx by d zeta is equal to LE by 2. Now, using the chain rule, I want dv by d zeta. So using a chain rule, dv by d zeta can be written as dv by dx. So this is nothing but a theta and dx by d zeta. So that can be written as dv by d zeta is equal to, I have dx by d zeta as L by 2. So I will substitute this as L by 2 into dv by dx, this theta. So in the sense, dv by d zeta is equal to L e by 2 into theta. So wherever dv by d zeta is there, that will take the value of this L e by 2 into theta. So this equation is rearranged as this. So v of zeta is equal to h1 v1 plus L e by 2 h2 into theta 1 plus h3 v2 plus L e by 2 h4 into theta 2. So the above equation, this equation can be written in a matrix form as v is equal to h into u, where h is a Hermite shape function those functions are h1, h2, h3 and h4, and u is nothing but a displacement vector, nodal displacement vector, so which includes of transverse displacement and angular displacement. So once we understand that concept of converting, why to convert from a global to a local, then we will apply the boundary conditions. So to understand this boundary conditions, so here you consider a element, the same element h is taken here, sorry, k is taken here, and it has a local coordinate system, zeta is equal to 0 and zeta is equal to minus 1 and zeta is equal to plus 1, and v1 is a transverse displacement at one, node 1, v2 is a transverse displacement at node 2, theta 1 angular displacement at node 1, theta 2 angular displacement at a node 2. Now when I consider these say functions, here zeta is equal to minus 1, so it is at a node 1. The effect of this say function is maximum at that particular node, and this is a property of a say function, we know this. So it will take a value of 1, and as it moves away from that node to the next node, its effect diminishes and becomes a 0. So in the sense, wherever h1 is there, you substitute that with the 1, and rest of the things like dh1 is 0, dh1 by d zeta is 0, h2 is 0, h2 is nothing but theta 1 is 0 here, h2 is basically, it is a non-derivative, so h2 will not have any significance here, but dh2 by d zeta is a theta 1, so if I take a differentiation of this one, it becomes a this. Okay, so this is a theta 1. So the effect of this angular displacement will be maximum where zeta is minus 1. So zeta is minus 1 here. So therefore dh2 by d zeta is 1 here. And rest all the things are 0 at the node 1. So these are the boundary conditions that we have to consider. Similarly, at a node 2, N2, the effect of the H3, that is associated with the V2, will be maximum at this point, and it diminishes as it goes away. So rest of the transverse displacement other than H3 will be 0. Similarly, the effect of the theta 2 angular displacement, which is associated with the dh4 by d zeta, this is theta 2, this is v2, this is theta 1 and theta v1. So the effect of a theta 2 is maximum here. So hence these equations, these boundary conditions can be understood. Okay, so wherever zeta at node 1, h1 has a maximum effect and theta 1 has a maximum effect. At a node 2, their effects are 0, but the effects of a v2, that is h3 and theta 2 will be maximum. So that's the reason I write here these values. Okay, so after understanding these boundary conditions, we have to apply these boundary conditions to the polynomial equation and derive h1, h2, h3 and h4. So with this, proceeding next, to derive the Hermite shape functions, consider a polynomial equation h1 is equal to a0 plus a1 zeta plus a2 zeta square plus a3 zeta cube. Now, from the boundary condition at node 1, at node 1 from the boundary conditions. So at node 1, at this point, zeta value is minus 1, h1 is 1. So I will use those things. At node 1, h1 is 1, zeta is minus 1, and dh1 by zeta is equal to 0. dh1 by zeta, d zeta is 0, and zeta value is minus 1. So I have taken these from the boundary condition table. So substituting this, these values into this equation, I'll get h1 is equal to 1, a0 I'll write as it is, a1 zeta is minus 1, so a1 into minus 1 will be minus a1 plus zeta square, so that will be a minus 1 the square, so it is plus 1, so plus a2, and zeta cube is minus 1, so it will be minus a3. So substituting these values into this equation, I am getting a equation A. Similarly, if I differentiate this equation, I will be getting dh1 by d zeta is equal to a0 is 0, a1 zeta becomes a1 plus zeta square will be 2 zeta into a2 plus zeta cube is 3 zeta square into a3. So substituting these value, dh1 divided by d zeta is 0 is equal to a1 as it is, zeta is equal to minus 1, so it will be minus 2a2 plus zeta square is plus 1, so it will be 3 a3. So by this we get a equation B. Now similarly, I will apply a boundary conditions at a node 2. So at a node 2, only h1 and dh1 is 0 and the zeta will be positive 1, because if I consider this as a beam, zeta is minus 1, zeta is plus 1. This is node 2, this is node 1. And h1 is equal to 0, dh1 by zeta is equal to 0. These we get from these boundary conditions. This one and another one is this. Okay. Now substituting the values, h1 is 0, a0 plus a1 plus zeta square is of 1 is 1, so it will be a2 plus a3, so I'll get a, b, c and d. Similarly, I will differentiate this, so the differentiation will same, only the values of a zeta will change. Instead of minus 1, it will be plus 1, so the after simplification I'll get this equation. Now I will use a, b, c, d to calculate what are the coefficients of a0, a1, a2 and a3. So for that, adding a and c, this and this, adding those two, I'll be getting 1 is equal to 2a0 plus 2a2. Upon simplification, I'll get a0 plus a2 is equal to 1 by 2. So that I am numbering as E. And this, adding B and D. So these two, adding those two, I'll get a new equation. 0 is equal to 2a1 plus 6a3 is equal to a1. So that implies a1 is equal to minus 3a3. So upon simplification of this, I'll get these two, f. Now substituting e and f in a c. So c is this part a naught, a1, a2 and a3. So a naught and a2 is written as 1 by 2, so that is comes here. And a1 I have a minus 3 a3 plus a3, so it becomes a minus 2 a3. So upon simplification I'll get the value of a3 as 1 by 4. Similarly, substituting this a3 here in this equation, I'll get a1 is equal to minus 3 by 4. Now from a equation D, I know a3 and I know a1, I can calculate a2. So that will be equal to a2 is equal to 0. So similarly, from this equation, a2 is 0, therefore a0 is equal to 1 by 2. So once I calculate a0, a1, a2 and a3, substitute these values into this equation. So a0 is 1 by 2, a1 is minus 3 by 4 into zeta, a2 is 0 plus a3 is 1 by 4. So upon simplification, I'll get a h1 as a safe function, which is written as 1 by 4 into 1 minus zeta's whole square into 2 plus zeta. Similarly, we have to calculate the safe functions for the h2. So again, here the process of this calculating h2 is similar to what we have calculated in a h1. So I will assume first the polynomial safe function, cubic polynomial safe function in a local coordinate system, and consider it as a h2. Then I will take the boundary conditions from the table. That is, if I click on this BC, so I'll take the boundary conditions from this table. So just to note what was required, H2 and DH2, 0 and 1. So go back, H2, 0, DH2 is 1. So here these two boundary conditions are taken here, and at a node 1 zeta value is minus 1, and substitute h2 is equal to 0 and zeta value is minus 1, then I'll get a equation A. Similarly, dh2 by d zeta, so differentiate this equation with respect to zeta, I'll get a1 plus 2 a2 zeta plus 3 a3 zeta square, and substitute the value of dh2 by d zeta as 1 here, and zeta is equal to minus 1, I'll get an equation B. So similarly, at node 2, the boundary condition table, so you can click on this. At node 2 means this zeta is equal to plus 1, and I have to consider these two values, so both will have a 0 value. Go back to the main equation, so this will have a 0 and 0, zeta is equal to plus 1, zeta is equal to plus 1, so substitute the value in this equation, so I'll get a equation C, and differentiate this and substitute the value of this here, and zeta is equal to plus 1, and arrive at a equation D. Now I have to add A plus C and B plus D to get a equation E and F. So that is shown in the next slide. So A plus C, we get 0 is equal to a naught plus a2, and adding b and d we get 1 is equal to 2e1 plus 6a3. Upon substitution I'll be getting what is e1 is equal to. So after getting e and f, I can calculate for other coefficients, like from this equation, that is substituting e and f in a c equation, this I can get the value of a3, and here substituting a3 in the f equation I'll be getting a1, so that is equal to a1 is equal to minus 1 by 4. Similarly in equation d, this equation I'll get a2 is equal to minus 1 by 4. And similarly from equation e, from this equation I have a2, so I can get a0 as 1 by 4. Now once I calculate a0, a1, a2 and a3, substitute that in a equation 2. So equation 2 is basically this. So a0, a1, a2 and a3 are substituted, and upon simplification I'll get what is the safe function for h2. Okay, so h2 is equal to 1 by 4, 1 minus zeta whole square plus into 1 plus zeta. So now we'll go for a calculation, calculating a safe function for the h3. Again the same procedure, assume polynomial displacement modulo as h3 is equal to cubic equation, get these boundary conditions, get these boundary conditions from the BC table. So that is h3 and ds3, h3 is 0, ds3 by d zeta is 0 for a node 1. So similarly for node 2 it is 1 and 0. So go back to this slide. So I have taken those boundary conditions from that at node 1 and at node 2, zeta value at node 1, zeta value at node 2, substitute the values into the this equation and get a, b, c and d. So repeat the procedure, a plus c, b plus d to get e and f equation, e and f equation, and substituting e and f in a c equation I'll get a3, and once a3 is known I can calculate a1, and from equation d, from this equation I can get a2, and from my equation e I'll get a0. Now you substitute the values of a0, a1, a2 and a3 into the equation 3, that is in this equation a0 1 by 2, a1 3 by 4, a2 is 0, a3 is minus 1 by 4. So upon the simplification I'll get a safe function for a h3. So similarly you can calculate safe functions for a h4 considering the cubic equation and getting the boundary conditions from the BC table, that is h4 and dh4 at node 1, h4 and dh4 divided by d zeta at node 2. So h4 and dh4 at node 1, h4 and dh4 at node 2. So zeta value is minus 1 and plus 1 at node 2. So going back, so this is calculated. Okay, so at this node, at node 1, H4 and DH4, I will substitute the values and I'll get these equations A, B, C and D, and A plus B, A plus C and D plus B. So to get E and F. So upon substitution, I can get the values of A3, A1, A2 and A0. So once this is calculated, substitute those values into this equation, and A0 is equal to minus 1 by 4, A1 is equal to minus 1 by 4, A2 is equal to 1 by 4 and A3 is equal to 1 by 4. And upon simplification, I'll get H4 is equal to 1 by 4 into 1 plus zeta whole square into zeta minus 1. So now we have calculated all the four shape functions, and these shape functions are called as the Hermite shape functions. The reason is it is the equations, the polynomials are similar to the cubic, Hermite and interpolation polynomial functions. So that's the reason we call them as a Hermite shape functions for a PM element. So what we have considered here is, first we have considered a polynomial equation in a global coordinate system that was converted into a local coordinate system as V of zeta, and then in a vector form we write V is equal to H into U, where H is a Hermite shape function, all this H1, H2, H3 and H4, and U is a displacement field vector, and H1, H2 and H3 and H4 are a Hermite shape functions. And you make a note of this H2 and H4. H1 is 1 by 4 here and H2 is LE by 8. So because this has to be multiplied with this one. So H2 and H4 will be multiplied by the LE by 2 because of this equation. So with this, we complete the Hermite shape functions for the beam element for a local coordinate system. Thank you.